transecting the omohyoideus muscle in the cranial half of the neck, but in the caudal half of the neck you don't have to transect anything. You just have to transect through the deep fascia of the neck. Okay? And then we're going to expose the carotid sheath, which would include four different structures in the horse. But we observe that in the donkey, one structure which is usually present within the carotid sheath in the horse is outside the carotid sheath. Okay, so what we have in the carotid sheath of the horse, we have a common carotid artery, then we have vagosympathetic trunk, then we have tracheal duct, which is also called tracheal trunk, which is the lymphatic. Okay, and then we have a recurrent laryngeal nerve in the horse is present within the carotid sheath. Okay, but we saw in the donkey, it is still outside the carotid sheath. It is lying probably along the trachea on both sides. But probably when we're going to do like deeper dissection of the thorax, we're going to trace those nerves and see like whether it is just branch of the recurrent laryngeal which is coming out to serve the esophagus or something. Okay, but we'll do that later. So now just consider for the horse, because we're going to like apply all this information to the horse. Okay, whenever there is some sort of difference, we'll mention that. Otherwise, most of the things that we learn on the donkey can be applied to the horse. Okay? With actual differences in the size, this could be easily applied to them. Okay? So we have carotid sheath with common carotid artery, vagosympathetic trunk, tracheal duct, as well as recurrent laryngeal nerve. So what structure is missing here? Internal jugular vein. Okay? In other animals, we have internal jugular vein present within the carotid sheath, and that's why this big vein is called external jugular vein. Okay, but here in the horse, there is no internal jugular vein. So, but we still have four structures because the recurrent laryngeal nerve has gone into the carotid sheath. So on both sides, then we have the same structure, two carotid sheaths, one on each side, common carotid arteries, vagosympathetic trunks, as well as recurrent laryngeal nerves inside that, as well as tracheal ducts inside the carotid sheath. Okay. Okay. On what side of the thoracic, or you can say, on what side of the trachea you usually find esophagus? In the middle part of the neck. It is usually on the left side in the mammals. In birds, it is exactly opposite. It is on the right side, but in mammals, it is present on the left side. So when you pass your stomach tube or something, you're gonna palpate it on the left side to see whether the tube is going in the right direction or not. Okay. As it moves further backward, then it's gonna go back to the dorsal aspect. At the beginning, it is present at the dorsal aspect. Middle, it is present on the left. As it goes caudally, it is again present on the dorsal aspect. Okay. So that is usually the course of the esophagus. Okay. We saw the structure of the trachea. Right in the middle here, we can access the trachea from the ventral midline, and that is the usual way of accessing the trachea for a tracheostomy or trachea. Okay, let's look at some of the lymph nodes in the neck region, and those are quite important. In the horse, we see the cranial deep cervical lymph nodes, not so big, but still those are present. Okay, then we see the caudal deep cervical lymph node and superficial cervical lymph node. Okay, now in order to expose the superficial cervical lymph node, what we'll have to do, we'll have to transect the brachiocephalicus and omotransversarius muscle, because superficial cervical lymph nodes are always located underneath the omotransversarius. So when I take that thing off, I'm going to see the superficial cervical lymph node. Okay, but now, does it look very different from lymph node that we have seen so far? Okay, it is in terms of the size of the lymph node and number of the lymph nodes. Okay, here in the horse, or we can say in the equine, we have more number of lymph nodes present which are smaller in size. In case of ruminants as well as in the dog, we have a large lymph node present at that site, and that would be just a major lymph node up there. So here, it may be also referred as lymphocenter sometimes. Okay? Instead of just calling lymph node, we can also say lymphocenter, because it is made up of many lymph nodes or aggregated lymph nodes. Okay? Still, palpating those lymph nodes is not so easy in the horse, because those would be covered by the omotransversarius, which is quite thick. Okay? But still, when they become excessively large, you can see the swelling, which would quickly or which would cause swelling on the sinus muscle. So when it comes to the major lymph node of the forelimb, the superficial cervical is the major lymph node of the forelimb because it drains forelimb or entire forelimb, including shoulder joint, or we can say shoulder region, neck as well as the head. Okay, so that's your superficial cervical lymph node. And as we trace those lymph nodes a little bit deeper or more close to the thoracic inlet, usually they would also merge with the caudal deep cervical lymph nodes. So smaller lymph nodes present at this side, probably those one which could be separated from that, okay, those would be the caudal deep cervical lymph nodes, but those are present within the visceral space of the neck, while superficial cervical lymph nodes are present outside the visceral space of the neck. Okay, so that's your superficial cervical lymph node or superficial cervical lympho center. Then this is the subclavius muscle. Okay, we saw in the goat that muscle was only limited to the shoulder joint. Now in the horse, that muscle is even better developed. It goes all the way towards the deep fascia of the supraspinatus muscle. Okay, so just for introduction, that is the subclavius. We're going to deal with that when we look at the forelimb, but just know for now this is the subclavius. Okay, I'm going to try to put everything back. That's your cutaneous coli. Okay, on this side as well as this side, that is the cutaneous coli. Or we can say that is the thickest part of the cutaneous coli. As it goes more on the ventral aspect as well as more cranially, it becomes thinner. As it goes laterally and dorsally, it becomes thinner. Okay, so this part is the thickest part of the cutaneous coli, which resembles the cutaneous coli of the horse. If I remove all that extension of the cutaneous coli from the donkey, it would look very similar to the horse. Okay, leaving that thick part of the cutaneous coli behind, everything would look similar to the horse. The way that they have shown it in the diagram in the lab manual, you will see it like this. Okay, so anything else? One important feature is the cephalic groove. What we see here now, these are the pectoral muscles. You have your descending pectoral muscle, which is part of the superficial pectoral groove. That's a descending pectoral muscle, and that's your brachiocephalicus muscle. Now here it is quite obvious that we see a groove located here. And then if I have some fluid, I can really put that in this vein, that is the cephalic vein. The cephalic vein is going to come from the medial aspect like this. Just go further up here, and then it goes deeper to join the external jugular vein on that particular side. And that groove, as it accommodates the cephalic vein, that is called cephalic groove. So which two muscles would form the cephalic groove? Descending pectoral and brachiocephalicus, or we can say cleidobrachialis. So we have two grooves in the neck region. We have groove for the external jugular vein, that is your jugular groove, and then we have the cephalic groove. Fortunately, because of the vein is empty here, the groove has become very prominent. So we can see the cephalic groove. There is something important about the cephalic groove is, in the horse, probably if they have some sort of like a hook or like cross the barbed wire or something, any injury in this region can lead to damage to the cephalic vein. And that will usually lead to perfusion. Secondly, just below the cephalic vein, there is also an artery present, which is branch of the superficial cervical artery, which is usually called deltoid branch of the superficial cervical. That is also located very close to the cephalic vein. So sometimes you may get artery damage instead of vein. Sometimes you may get vein damage only but not the artery. Sometimes you get both of them damage. Depending upon the severity and depth of the injury, you will get those kind of bleeding. So you will have to differentiate what kind of bleeding you see, and then you decide whether you like it below the injury or above the injury. For the artery, as it is located deep, we won't really like be able to ligate anything. But for the vein, at least we can go below the injury and try something, so bleeding will stop or it will reduce. The artery is deltoid branch of the superficial cervical, and the vein is something cephalic vein. Okay, so cephalic groove, jugular groove. Then we saw the superficial muscles of the neck. Okay, now just quickly look at that and see that if we are missing something.